Okay, hi. So this is the presentation that I got together for Friedrichshafen called Let's Get Real IFR in Practice. And it's supposed to be about the reality of doing IFR planning and flying in Europe as opposed to the theory. So let's just share the PowerPoint. So you passed your skills test, brilliant, well done. And the idea is that you're now ready to go anywhere, anytime. But are you really? There's a lot of stuff not covered in the IR test, and the purpose of this talk is to cover some of that material, at least to demystify it, but also to give you some hints and tricks as to how to turn the IR into a useful tool for European touring. So personally, I mainly fly Piper, Navajos and Chieftains. I've had an instrument rating for about 40 years, and in that time I've done about 5,000 hours IFR in Europe in various kinds of aircraft, but mostly twins and light jets. At the moment I fly about 5 sectors a week, and very often at short notice. I have a boss who just calls me up in the morning and says, can we do such and such, expecting to go in, you know, an hour, 90 minutes later. And so I've got it down that I can plan a flight in a few minutes in the back of a taxi. But that's not to say that planning is a race. A lot of people enjoy the planning part as much as the flying. And it takes a while to combine speed with being able to do it properly. So I'm not suggesting that everyone should now be able to do it in 5 minutes, but all I'm saying is that if you need to, you can, with modern tools, you can get it down to that kind of length of time. So I've broken this up into a few different sections. The first step is just the general feasibility. Can the flight be done given the fuel and the weather and distances and so on? Secondly, airfield information. So things like customs availability, opening hours, fuel availability, that kind of thing. The Eurocontrol route, which historically has been the most difficult thing about flying IFR in Europe, but now has been made very easy by various tools. Weather, and we'll talk about that and how easy that's been made by various tools. NOTAMs, same thing, used to be a huge problem. Now it's made very easy by various tools. Sorry to keep repeating myself. Same thing with weight and balance. And then we'll talk a little bit about flying at the end. And there you see a picture of me in a fairly typical, this is the flight deck of my own aircraft, but it's fairly typical of the aircraft that I fly. So taking a scenario, let's say the boss calls me up and says, right, I need to fly from Biggin to Stuttgart, dropping my wife in Clermont-Ferrand with a quick turnaround. What time can I set my meeting up in Stuttgart? That would be not an untypical thing for him to say to me at 7:30 in the morning, expecting to be a meeting in Stuttgart by the early afternoon. So the first thing I do is I just put the route into flight demon, not the route, but the stopping points into Sky Demon, just literally with in this case, I'd probably put Biggin to Stuttgart and then rubber band it to Clermont-Ferrand, just to get an idea in my head. I'd look at the clog and get the times and distances from that. And then I just add on, I know that Eurocontrol is unlikely to add more than 15% to my route. And indeed, as we'll be talking about later, I'm unlikely to fly even that 15%. So I have 15% for Eurocontrol, 30 minutes on the ground, 70 litres for prime, 200 litres for halt and alternate, and I come out with a feasibility answer, a yes or no, generally speaking, in about 60 seconds. So he calls me up, I say, hold on a second, blah, 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 and then, yeah, I think we can do that. If he then, what would typically would happen is that he would then say, okay, well, plan it and let me know when we're going. So the first thing I then do is go to the airfield information for those various airfields. And there are lots of possible places I can get it from. I can get it from the flight planning apps, I can get it from websites, AccuQuick, Jeppesen, many, many places. But they all use the AIPs as their source material, and that's already at your fingertips, in my case in SkyDemon, but in various places you can see the AIP. So I tend to go back to the source material. And on my SkyDemon, I keep the whole of Europe offline, already downloaded on the iPad, so it's just there, whatever the circumstances, both in flight and if I'm in a poor signal area or whatever. I have to remember to do it for departure, destination, and alternate airfields. And the first thing I'm looking at, obviously, is opening hours, because sometimes he's not saying, I want to go in the middle of the day. He quite often says, and can you bring me back after my meeting ends or after my dinner ends at 9 o'clock in the evening or whatever it might be. One thing I've found is you have to be very careful when the opening hours say H24 or HJ, which means hours of daylight, but they tend to, or even if they say H24 and HJ, there are often other restrictions, so you have to look carefully behind that. H24 might mean that the firemen are on duty all the time, but they only accept either cargo flights or whatever. So just check for the restrictions when you see that. Bear in mind customs and immigration. First of all, not all of Europe is Schengen, so some places you still need to get immigration control. That is shortly going to apply to the UK, but also a lot of the Balkans, though some of them, the ones marked in yellow here, are joining Schengen in the relatively near future. But also you have to be careful about customs. Notoriously, Switzerland is outside the customs union, so you need to leave from and enter via customs airports. Customs airports are different from immigration airports, so you just have to be quite careful about knowing whether customs and immigration is available on the routes you're flying. Avgas availability, often a big problem at big airports, and an increasing problem. For example, particularly Norway, there are very few sources of Avgas, but Avgas is getting an increasing problem, obviously, if you're flying an Avgas-burning aircraft. And then finally, PPR and slots. A lot of airfields, big airports all over Europe, and a lot of smaller ones, particularly in the UK, require PPR. Sometimes that PPR is not required if you file a flight plan, and all sorts of different things. So you just need to look at the AIP, just check what the slots and PPR situation is. It's not usually a problem, it's just if you don't do it, it becomes a problem. IFR minima, so look at the IFR plates, what are the minima. If you're going somewhere where you need, say, a 400-foot cloud base to get in, or if one of the runways is far preferable to the other, and so on. You just need to have in your mind what the IFR minima are, and therefore what can be what the minimum weather you can have is. You may need to take into account costs. Some airports, even some GA airports, are massively expensive. The two that spring to mind are Le Bourget and Farnborough, where landing and being handled and taking off again in a light twin, or possibly even a light single, can be well in excess of €1,000. So although you may be fairly flexible about a few hundred euros, there are some places where it becomes prohibitively expensive. There, but surprisingly, there are some places like large airports in Germany and indeed in France where it's surprisingly cheap. So it might be worth bearing in mind and trying to find out what the costs are. Often they're on the PPLIR forum, but otherwise a phone call to handling agents or whatever normally sorts that out. So the second thing is to sort out a Eurocontrol route and to file a plan. It used to be a horrible job that took maybe 90 minutes to find a route that worked. But we're very lucky now to have various tools at our disposal that do this automatically. Rocket route is an excellent way of doing it, but it is an expensive way of doing it. And there's also there's various alternatives. For example, ForeFlight does this, but there is actually an excellent and free solution in AutoRouter, and that's what I tend to use. Once AutoRouter has given you a route, don't worry too much about finessing it. Just accept anything it gives you that goes roughly in the right direction through the right sectors, because ATC will be giving you directs anyway, so you don't have to worry about the route being 10 or 15% more than Great Circle. It will just get sorted out in the air, and that's almost invariably, except sometimes in some parts of Eastern Europe it can be a problem, but almost invariably, you won't fly the route that you'll file anyway. And the same goes for altitude changes. AutoRouter in particular does tend to climb you by a couple of thousand feet and then descend you by a couple of thousand feet in order to get round restrictions. But in reality, it doesn't happen. So long as the altitude changes are within a range that you can fly, just accept them, because when you fly along, the worst that will happen is ATC will say, do you wish to climb to 120? And you say, no, I'm perfectly happy at 100. And they say, fine, continue at 100. And that's the worst that happens. You're very rarely forced into the changes that are filed, if ever. Once we've done that, both RocketRoute and AutoRouter phone apps allow us to get slot messages, freeze and unfreeze slots, replan our estimated off-block time, send departure and arrival messages, cancel. So all those things are handled on the ramp or wherever you are, making life a lot easier. But fuel planning is something... It can be a bit of an issue, because the question is, are you going to plan the fuel for the Eurocontrol route or for the much more direct route that you expect to get? And to give examples of how silly this can get, these are all real routes that I've been offered by AutoRouter. So the first one is Calais to Biggin, which goes up to Dover, back down almost to the French coast, and then into Biggin. That's clearly never going to happen. Second one is a departure from Gstaad, which takes me all the way into France and over Lyon, places like that, before it finally sets off towards Straubing. Again, it's never going to happen. The clearance is always going to be straight up to the north. And then the last one, the most dramatic and the least likely, though I've never actually flown it, I have planned it, is from Biggin to City Airport, which is a distance of something like 8 or 9 miles. And the only standard route takes you round to Dover and Manston and back via the Thames Estuary. Why would you need to take as much fuel as you require to do that when you know perfectly well it's going to radar handover? But the purists will tell you, if that's the route filed, you need to plan the fuel for it, Personally, I don't agree. It probably slightly depends on whether there are en route alternates available, such that if you were made to fly the route, you could land short. So, for example, if you look at the one from Switzerland to Germany, if push came to shove and I was made to fly around that huge triangle, then I could, if necessary, go into, say, Augsburg or Karlsruhe if I couldn't make it all the way to Straubing. This only really matters if you're doing a long route. But for example, I planned a route from Liverpool to Gdansk. The route took me a very odd way over the North Sea, which I didn't have enough fuel for, but it was perfectly clear that I would get a straight line across the North Sea, which I would have fuel for. And so it can become a real issue that you have to take decisions about. Moving on to the weather. Weather, it used to be a question of looking at various rather obscure documents, MET forms and skew diagrams and so on, but it's now been enormously simplified by a number of online resources. Windy.com, Gramet, Golzer, all of which I will describe in a little bit more detail. So Windy.com is both a website and it's available on apps, and it's free to use, and you can set it up to have aviation weather. So for example, the things I'm about to show you, rainfall, visibility, cloud base, and wind, the four main things that we're interested in. You can set it up to show those. You can also set up pickers to show you what the forecast for whichever one you're looking at a particular place. And then you have a time slider scale, so you can see how the weather system is moving and so on. So in this case, I can pick up the rainfall, the visibility, the cloud base, and the wind. And the wind one can do at any level or altitude you choose, including the surface. So you get a very good picture both of en route winds and any likely problems with wind at departure and destination and alternate fields. So windy.com, as I say, it's available on website and in apps. It's free of charge, and as far as I'm concerned, it's completely changed how we do aviation weather. It enables you to visualize and enables you to see how systems are moving, so you can take the decision that it's better to go in the morning than the afternoon or whatever it might be. The second system that has enabled us to visualize weather is Gramet. There are a couple of possible sources of Gramet. The one I recommend is from AutoRouter. And it comes free with AutoRouter. If you've done your flight planning through AutoRouter, it automatically picks up the plans and routes. So, for example, if you put in your route 4 or 5 days in advance, you can keep an eye on it just by putting in Gramet route one, or whichever number the route is, over the days, and it shows you if there's any change. And when you've put it in as a plan, you just say Gramet one, and it automatically gives you the Gramet for your plan. It's available on web, phone, and tablet. And as I say, you can do it days in advance. It gives you cloud, precipitation, freezing level, ice, thunderstorm activity, and wind, all in a cross section like this. So this particular one is going from Fair Oaks to, I think that's Gstaad. And you can see the weather that you're likely to be climbing up through and then flying in. The green area is icing. The little parallel lines are rain, and you can see magenta lines for the wind compared to the forecast, or your track compared to the forecast wind. Hugely valuable resource, enabling you to picture what the flight's going to be like, and usually pretty accurate, not 100%, pretty good. And then finally, the GOGSA system, which is both for pre-flight and in-flight weather. You have a little box either which you carry into the cockpit or is installed in the cockpit, and gives you TAFs, METARs, precipitation, cloud, lightning, wind and temperature. And on here you see an example. If you have it in the aircraft, if you're plumbed into the aircraft, then it also gets your route from your navigator and puts that on. That's what the green line is. And this is showing magenta is lightning strikes, red and purple and yellow, orange and so on are amounts of precipitation. The grey is cloud without precipitation. And it also, as I say, gives you wind at different altitudes, as well as temperatures, and you can pick up TAFs and METARs. It's a very, very well engineered product. So although it works on Iridium, which is an expensive technology, the author, Sebastian Goltzer, has done an excellent job at compressing the data so that the costs are actually relatively low. I fly a lot, and I very rarely have a monthly bill of more than about maybe 30 euros. And that's flying a lot. If you just do the occasional trip, it will almost not be noticeable. Do beware that the radar data is always out of date. It's a minimum of about 4 minutes out of date, and depending on where in the cycle you're looking, a maximum of about 20 minutes out of date, because there's a download every 15 minutes. That takes 4 minutes to process. So the first time you see it is the situation as it was 4 minutes ago, and then as the 15 minutes decay, so it becomes older and older. So you need to be, so you can't use it as a tactical way of avoiding thunderstorms, but you just know where they were between 5 and 20 minutes ago. It gives you low-cost in-flight SMS texting as well. So if you want to text home and give an ETA or whatever, you can do that. In my opinion, it's the best thing and the best value addition to the IFR pilot's toolkit for many years. And I recommend everyone to have one of these boxes. I almost would say it's no longer makes a lot of sense to do IFR touring without one. And they're not hugely expensive, a small number of hundreds of euros. So very, very well worth buying. And I should say, I have no interest in the company. I'm just a satisfied customer. So I'm not pushing it from a commercial point of view. I'm just recommending it as someone who thinks they're wonderful. So moving on to NOTAMs. I get graphical and textual NOTAMs from SkyDaemon. There are many other sources of getting them. All the flight planning programs have them, some of them better than others. Some of them only have lateral extent, whereas the SkyDaemon and some others also show you the vertical extent. They're timed, so you can see when they're coming in and going out. It's just a very, very easy way of, you look at your whole route. So for example, in this particular one, you can see my magenta line goes here, and I've just come down and had a little bit of a look at what this NOTAM is about. You can see the words down here, but also if you put the mouse over them, they pop up the contents. So it really has made NOTAMs go from an hour-long exercise of sitting in the crew room reading hundreds of pages of tightly printed A4 sheets to just having a quick glance at the graphical view, seeing which ones are relevant, and moving on. And also, yes, using SkyDaemon, and I'm sure the same is true for many other flight planning systems and in-cockpit flight systems, is that they provide in-flight alerts and warnings. So they'll tell you, just like they tell you with controlled airspace, they'll say that you're approaching a no time and warn you what it is. Fuel and weight and balance. Again, many apps, Sky Demon, Rocket Route, Auto Router, Four Flight, give you weight and balance calculations, and I'm sure they're absolutely fine. Personally, I use Excel because I've programmed it, I know exactly what it's telling me, and I'm not relying on other products to do it. That may just be paranoid on my part, but I just like to know exactly what I'm looking at. But all of them are much the same. You can see the red line shows me takeoff and landing weight and balance, and shows me they're both within the envelope. But as I say, many apps do exactly the same thing, and you may prefer to use this. It's just me that likes to use Excel, but I can do it very, very quickly. It probably takes a tiny number of keystrokes, because things like my own weight and my flight bag and so on are already in there. So it's just a question of putting in, and I normally take off with full fuel. So it's usually just a question of putting in passengers and their baggage, and we're off. I also save what I've done so that if I am ramp checked, I can show the ramp checker that that I did the weight and balance and that it was in limits. And I would say the whole process takes about 15 seconds, as opposed to the many, many minutes it used to take when I was doing this commercially. We had to do everything on paper and on multi-carbon sheets and so on. Slots. What you've got on the screen here is a very typical slot message. So it's telling me on this route, the slot time. The slot can be on time or it can be a delay. It usually gives at the bottom the reason, though that's not particularly relevant or helpful, except it might occasionally allow you to replan around the restriction. I'll come on to that in a moment. In my personal experience, they're becoming more common, probably with the shortage of ATCOs around Europe. Having said that, of course, at the moment we're in lockdown and there's almost no activity, aviation activity in Europe. What will happen when everyone comes back from furlough, whether it would be better because there are fewer airliners or worse because there are fewer ATCOs, we don't know. But just going historically on the way it's been over the last couple of years, it is getting increasingly common to get a slot. Auto Router does warn you about where potential restrictions would be. Each of those colors is a different length of time, from maybe 10 minutes to 2 hours or whatever, depending on the strength of the color. So you can get a rough idea of what the restrictions would be. And so in this particular case, you could possibly plan a route further south to avoid those delays. But even further south, you've got that area between Koblenz and Düsseldorf. So it may or may not be worth replanning. Slots are sent out by email or text or telegram from Auto Router. I'm sure that each of the systems has its own way of sending them out. Just to warn you that if you get a slot, so let's say you're planning to go at 12 o'clock and you get a delay till, say 1 o'clock, if you try and be clever and refile for 11 o'clock, hoping you'll get a delay to 12, the system seems to know better than that and seems to then give you a delay till 1:30 or whatever. So filing an earlier time, having already filed, is not usually a good idea. Doing it as a basis, from the basis of what Auto Router tells you is going to be the likely delay, might be a better idea. And sometimes sending a ready message, which you can either do directly or through ATC, I'm not sure if you can do it directly, actually, but anyway, you can either do it directly or through ATC, and that sometimes improves the slot, though it often doesn't. I won't say annoyingly, because it's sometimes helpful, but quite often you'll get a whole series of slots. So first of all, you'll be told there's an hour's delay, then you'll be told it's 45 minutes, then you'll be told it's 30 minutes, and then you'll get one saying you can go now. And that is, if you're ready to go, if you're sitting there ready to start the engines, it's fine. But if you've let the passengers go off to the cafe, it's more of a problem. So you can freeze the slots if you want to. So let's say you've got a slot, a delay of half an hour. You can put in a freeze command, and that means that you can just tell the passengers to be back at a certain time, ready to go for the slot. It's horses for courses. You make the choice for each flight as circumstances suggest. And you can always consider, depending on the weather and the route and the circumstances, if you get a very long delay. I mean, I have had, historically, I've had a five-hour delay, which actually makes the whole trip not worth doing. And then you can consider cancelling IFR and refiling VFR, which, given all the facilities offered by SkyDemon, isn't such a silly idea, depending on your aircraft type and the nature of the airspace and so on. But if you do that, also bear in mind it'll be a much more tiring flight, as you're working out as you go the restrictions, airspace, who to talk to next, and all the things that IFR protects us from. Now, talking about the flying itself, some people are nervous about ATC. My experience of ATC is that, although there have, in my long history of flying, been some exceptions to this rule, mostly they are helpful and cooperative. They want to get the job done as much as we do, and especially so if you, as the pilot, are helpful and cooperative in return. It's a team effort, and if we're on the same side, generally speaking, ATC will be great. We are very lucky, that's to say, most of the people to whom this talk is addressed are very lucky that we fly at fairly empty levels. So between, let's say, flight level 100 and flight level 220, outside the terminal airspace, there's very little other traffic. And generally speaking, we get long directs. So what we're looking at now is exactly what happened to me on a recent flight going out of Fair Oaks. The blue line was what was planned, and almost as soon as I was airborne, I was redirected off to, I think it was probably Alesso on the FIR boundary, and then before I got there, re-cleared on a continuing straight line. And this is very typical of what we see. It's unusual to fly the routes that we've planned, and they usually, the ATC are usually very helpful in giving those directs. The downside of that is, of course, you have to be ready to accept the directs, and I strongly recommend having the flight plan up on your GNSS unit, so that if you're flying from Rinty to Tracker, as we are here, and then you're told direct to Reims, then you can just highlight it, click direct, and off you go. And that's always, when you're given a direct, that's always the first place to look, is on your GNSS flight plan. A problem can arise as to, particularly when you're listening to a controller who's foreign to your language, and might have an accent, as to if you're not familiar with all the waypoints, or if it's an unusual waypoint, what have they actually said? So on the radio, Samak, Samax, Samak, and Sanak all sound pretty similar. And so there can be confusion, either because two of those exist or because you don't know which one you're looking for. So the first thing to do, in my suggestion, is you read it. You read back what you've heard, because ATC can be quite busy, and you don't want to be taking up unnecessary time. So if you can work it out for yourself in a few seconds, so much the better. So read it back. Look at your GNSS flight plan. Can you see it there? If you can't, look on the chart in the general direction where you expect it to be, towards your destination, and just have a quick look around to see if it's an obvious place. And then finally, go back to them and ask them to spell it. They never mind spelling it. It's never an issue. So you just go back, ask them to spell it. They spell it out. You can put it into your GNSS as a direct, start flying it, and then once you've started flying it, you can find it on the chart, see where in your flight plan it should fit, and then insert it into your flight plan, at which point the aircraft will automatically go from our direct to sequencing within the flight plan. That's something that comes up very often in new, inexperienced IFR pilots is what to do if you're just given a direct to a waypoint and nothing beyond it. And you know, some people think that they're supposed to hold when they get there or whatever, but that's not the case. If the flight plan's on the route, on your original route, like this example here, then you just continue on the flight plan route. That's what ATC is expecting you to do. If it's not on your route, then unless you hear any different from them, just continue to the next sensible waypoint on the plan. So in this case, continuing in more or less a straight line to somewhere a bit further on the plan. You wouldn't do a hard right turn to join the plan adjacent. You'd just continue. That's what they're expecting. But of course, if in any doubt, ask what they are expecting. But generally speaking, it will be to a point on the flight plan, and you just then continue on your flight plan route until you hear otherwise. Just a little bit about large TMAs, London, Amsterdam, Frankfurt, places like that. Expect a lot of vectors, particularly, in all three of those, but I'd say particularly in the London TMA, you just never fly the route you plan. It's always vectors. A couple of years ago, I was given a SID out of Biggin Hill, and I flew it, and I was never given a vector, and it was so surprising, because that had not happened to me in the previous 30 years, that I actually had a conversation with the ATCO about it, because it was the first time it had happened in, let's say, 20 or 30 years of flying out of Biggin Hill. Every time it's vectors. The radio will be busy, so don't hover, as I see a lot of relatively new IFR pilots doing, with their fingers quivering over PTT, because you will never be able to talk. You just have to wait for the millisecond that the previous conversation finishes, and you have to listen out when a response is expected and when it isn't. And the moment that happens, press transmit. Other people will be doing the same. Sometimes you collide, but it's the only way to do it. You have to keep your transmission short, know what you're going to say, only read back what you need to read back. Don't use pleasantries, just keep everything short and sharp. I speak in COVID times about isolating yourself. This talk was actually written before our present times, but it's ironic now. But you must isolate yourself from your passengers and from any extraneous noise. So all you can hear is ATC. And that also means if you've got a co-pilot or a pilot passenger, don't be chatting, just listen. And bear in mind that the route flown can be wildly different from what you've planned. I, for example, have been going into somewhere in the West, I think Gloucester, from Europe, and had planned, I think, to go south of Gatwick and ended up going north of Luton. And that's not uncommon. It can be wildly different. Be ready to ask what their plan for you is. if you're being sent off in a direction that doesn't make any sense, ask them, just say, what's your plan? And they'll tell you, it's not a problem. Some ATC provides weather assistance. That's particularly true in Germany, but there are other places as well, where they will actually, if asked, and only if asked generally, will say, oh yes, there's a CV on that route, or I suggest you turn left, or whatever it might be. It is possible, it's not usually offered, but if you, for example, are short of fuel, you can ask them to coordinate for your whole route and say, you know, please can you ask your colleagues further down the line if I could go via whatever, where, you know, wherever it is, in order to get in a straight line. And if the answer comes back no, then you might want to think about diverting. But if it sounds like you are going to get a direct routing, then you can get reassurance about that. It doesn't always happen, and it's horses for courses, but it's always worth a try. Usually, particularly at our levels where there isn't a lot of traffic, you can ask for level changes. You must never make a level change unless you're cleared, but you can ask for a level change either because you've got a much stronger headwind than you were expecting, or indeed to take advantage of a tailwind, or to stay out of bumpy cloud for the sake of your passengers, or of course to avoid icing. So you usually can ask and will be granted for a level change in the kind of levels that we're talking about, between 80 and 240. Sometimes in busy TMAs, there just isn't the time for that, and there isn't the capacity. And bearing in mind, in the TMAs, the big jets are down at our levels as well, and then you just have to suck it up and take the levels you're given. Unless, we'll be talking about icing later, unless you're actually icing or risking going into very serious turbulence. Another thing that people often ask about is descent and how to liaise with ATC. You do need to plan your descent a way back, either using the technology. For example, your navigator may well have a mode that gives you that you say, I need to be at this level by this position, and then it will come back and tell you when to start the descent. That's quite common these days, but with older tech, you need to do it by mental math. Unpressurized aircraft, you do need to descend at a minimum of 500 feet a minute. That's the IFR rules. And you don't want to exceed that for the sake of your passengers' comfort and ears. And therefore, you should plan all your descents at exactly 500 feet a minute. Obviously, that doesn't apply to pressurized aircraft. The way you do it is you calculate the altitude change you require. You know that at 500 feet a minute, that's 2 minutes per 1,000 feet. So therefore you get a number of minutes. So let's say you need to go down 5,000 feet, that's going to take 10 minutes. You know the speed you're doing. So let's say you're doing 120 knots, 2 miles a minute. And if you have to go down for 10 minutes, 2 miles a minute, then that's, I've lost count of what I was saying now, 20 minutes, I think. 20 miles. Or whatever it is, but you can work it out using that very quickly. And then you get a point from which you want a descent. However, ATC generally are not as used to non-pressurized aircraft as pressurized ones, and therefore are unlikely to prompt you for descent as early as you would like, because they'll be expecting you to go down at 2,000 feet a minute or whatever. So therefore you should request descent, and also request descent and give them enough time to plan. They can't, generally speaking, particularly in the TMA, they can't just give you a descent. They have to think about how that descent's going to affect their other traffic and have a look at the other maggots going across their screen and how you're going to interact with them and so on. So I usually request descent when my automatics tell me that I require a rate of descent of about 420 feet a minute. Part of that is so that it gives them time to plan, so that by the time I get to the top of the descent, it's close to 500, but also in the descent, you go faster and therefore that number is going to increase. You're going to have to go at a steeper rate of descent at a higher speed. So therefore, if you start at about 420, 425 feet per minute on your automatics, then you probably get the descent when you get to about 450, 460, and then you start the descent, you're going down faster than you would otherwise have been, than you were previously going. And so your rate of descent turns out to be 500 feet a minute. It usually works out, and it really doesn't matter if it's 600 feet a minute. It's just trying to finesse it as much as you can. If you're given, say you're at flight level 100 and you're told to descend to 70 and you need a continuous descent, then as you get to about 75, you request further descent, again giving them time to plan so that before you get to 70 you can continue down. It's a bit of a pain to have to level off, increase power, whatever you need to do, and then 10 seconds later be given further descent. So you're trying again to finesse it so you get a continuous descent. And the other thing to remember is that they want us out of their hair. This picture of a radar display is nothing special. It's very, very typical. This is the environment through which most of the aircraft are doing more than 250 knots. You're doing 120 knots. You are causing them difficulties just by doing that. And therefore, they are doing their best to find a way to get you off their screen as quickly as they can. And that's where the cooperation comes in. They will give you instructions to, and generally speaking, those instructions will get you out, get you off their screens as fast as possible. And then the big thing about ATC, something that people continuously forget, is if in doubt, ask. If there's any question in your mind as to what you're supposed to be doing, or if you've misheard something, or you fear you might have misheard something, or you can't read your writing, ask. I am often get into trouble with ATCOs for the following description, but I think it's fair. ATCOs are waiters, they're not policemen. They are people there to do your bidding if you ask them in a nice way. They're not there to stand over you with a whip and punish you. Just ask them, they're nice blokes or girls. Okay, moving on to the experience of ice while flying. Ice is a serious matter even if you have de-icing equipment. You can lose 40 knots in a light aircraft. It can take you into the stall. I'm not going to go through the theory of icing. We all know why icing is a bad idea: extra weight, aerodynamic inefficiency, all those things. It's a serious matter. Before you go, you should brief for ice. I showed you this Gramet earlier, and it shows us going up through that area of ice. So we can maybe stop our climb before we get there, obviously with clearance, or we can aim to get higher. Whatever it is, we try to avoid, or in a non-de-iced aircraft, we avoid. In a de-iced aircraft, we try as hard as we can to avoid going through those areas of ice. Ice invariably forms in a band, so it would be most unusual for ice to be present from the surface to 20,000 feet. Ice, as we know from our theory, only exists between 0 and minus 15, though I have war stories to tell of it forming outside that range, but generally speaking, 0 to minus 15. So there's only going to be a few thousand feet which is ice bearing, and therefore you can escape up or down. So you should always consider, if for example in this case here you can see that there's blue sky above you, then that may be the better way to go. And if you've picked up some ice in the green area and climb and get above it, the ice will sublimate off in the sunshine. It's not a question of, because it's colder, it will always stay there. It will dissipate, but it will dissipate slower than if you descend below the icing, the 0 degree isotherm. And generally speaking, if you say you are icing, ATC will take it very seriously. You don't have to declare urgency or emergency. But if either they don't take it seriously or your situation is beginning to get grave, don't hesitate to declare an emergency. It is an emergency. If your aeroplane isn't flying properly, it's an emergency. And once you declare an emergency, they essentially will do for you whatever you need in order to get you out of it. There will be paperwork to do afterwards, but that's paperwork's always better than crashing and dying. Something that people I sometimes see forgetting is to put on anti-ice and de-ice measures when they should. It varies from aircraft to aircraft, but make sure that your pitot head is on, prop heat, alternate air. That it's easy enough to remember to do the wing de-icing, but do remember for your own aircraft type what else you need to have on. Little bit on thunderstorms, because that's another big worry when we're flying IFR. Use some kind of detection. If you're above the clouds, then you could, and this is the most common way to interact with a thunderstorm, you see the kind of picture you see here. But otherwise, onboard radar, the Goltzer system that I mentioned earlier, storm scope, or as I said earlier, in some countries you can ask ATC, but one way or another you need to know where they are. If you remember when we were talking about the Goltzer system, I talked about the fact that there's a delay. There is a play function within Goltzer that allows you to watch which way thunderstorms are moving, and so you can forecast for yourself. If it was there half an hour ago and it was there a quarter of an hour ago, then in all likelihood it will be here now. It's not great, but it helps. But also remember that in some places, particularly in the Swiss Alps or in the Alps generally, thunderstorms don't move, they just appear and disappear in place. So the play function is not going to help you with that. What you should do, say we have the picture that you can see in the background here, then you should ask for so many degrees left or right for weather. So you say, request 10 degrees left for weather, and nearly always they will grant it. Sometimes they will say, how long do you need that for? Because they need to do their own planning. And sometimes they might say, can you take a right turn? But generally speaking, they do what you ask. Whatever happens, do not go into one. And if ATC aren't being cooperative, you may just have to announce your intentions and turn away and leave them to sort out the mess. Because you shouldn't be putting your and your passengers' lives at risk by entering one of these things. Again, it will end up in paperwork, but paperwork is better than death. So don't go into one just because ATC tell you to. The responsibility remains yours. If you do end up in one, then the top of the green band on the ASI is what's called VA. And the penetration speed, generally speaking, in the kind of aircraft we're flying, at the kind of speeds we're flying, is about 80% of that. So bring your speed back to 80% of the top of the green band. Turn off the autopilot and try and remain calm and focused. Otherwise, if you start getting panicked, you're likely to be in a much worse position. Make gentle corrections to heading and altitude. Don't try and, don't obsess. No one else is going to be fool enough to be in there with you. So if you do go up and down by 1,000 feet, if you do find your heading is, because of turbulence, your heading changes, you're not going to hit anyone. So just gently put it back to the heading and altitude you want, but never with a lot of control force. And although in America and Africa, these things can break up an aircraft, In Europe, they're never that bad. It may be very nasty indeed, but if you do what I've just said, you will survive the experience. Now moving on to the equipment that you have. Use all the equipment you have at your disposal to reduce the workload and enable you to think. You're thinking about fuel, about weather, about all the other things you need to think about. So use the autopilot as much as possible. I would say keep your hand flying skills up by occasional practice, but essentially apart from that, use the autopilot all the time so you can use your brain for other things. Use roll steering, which again keeps you on the on your planned route even as you go through a waypoint, meaning that you have to put even less attention, although of course you need to monitor what the autopilot's doing, you have to put less attention into coming from nav mode into heading mode and back into nav mode at each waypoint. Use VNAV mode if you have it. It will give you vertical guidance as well as you having lateral guidance. Use a moving map, whether you're IFR or VFR, so you're always orientated. You can see both controlled airspace and get procedures and so on in front of you. As I said earlier, keep the waypoint list on the navigator so you can quickly flick you can quickly do a direct to points further ahead. Use the fuel planning function on the navigator if you've got it. If you don't have it, you have to be working out your fuel all the time. If you have it and you know you can trust it, and it's telling you your arrival fuel, for example, then you can put much less mental effort into fuel planning. Cross-fill, if you've got more than one GNSS, makes life easier. And flight stream from something like Garmin Pilot or ForeFlight, so it goes straight into the box. All of these things are just going to reduce your the mental work you need to put in. So use them. If you don't have them, you can still, of course, fly. I mean, I'm not saying you need all that stuff to fly, but you might need to think more about your workload and maybe possibly get shorter trips or more benign weather or whatever. And you also need to think which of the items are no-go items, and that may well be determined by circumstances. So, for example, you certainly, if you're flying VMC, even if it's IFR, then you need the autopilot much less than if you're flying in hard IMC the whole way. Right, moving on to plates. Constant question arising on the PPLIR forum and elsewhere. Which plates do I use? Do I use Jeppesen or do I use AIP? And I'll be talking a little bit about Navigraph as well in a moment, which are Jeppesen plates. So there on the left is a Jeppesen plate. Then the German AIP plate, and we'll be talking about Navigraph as well, as I say. First issue is one of consistency. Here I've just got five examples of different AIP plates, and you can see that they're all different. They all have information in different places on the page. So if you're flying all over Europe, you either need to familiarize yourself with each country you're going to, or give yourself plenty of time to brief as you look for that snippet of information on each sheet. The AIP plates are not originally written to be used in flight. They're written so that people like Jeppesen can produce flight-ready systems. So readability can be an issue. I mean, this one that I happened across, the written word is almost indistinguishable from the background topography, and it makes it very, very hard to read what you're supposed to do. Whereas a jet plate, you would never have something like that. Completeness. This is the minima plate from, or the, sorry, the minima section from a UK plate. First of all, notice it has no RVR. The only legally enforceable minima, as I'm sure we all know, is the RVR, not mentioned in most AIPs at all. I think it possibly is in the French ones, but nearly all AIP plates do not have the minimum RVR mentioned, meaning you need to find a different way to calculate that, and there are apps for that, but it's a pain. So you don't have the RVR minima. And also, in this particular case, and that's why I picked this one, if you look at the Cat A obstacle clearance altitude, it says 248 feet. So you might think, great, that's my decision altitude. But if you then look at the OCH, you'll see that actually that's below Cat 1 minima, which is 200 feet, system minima. So therefore, you have to add 7 feet to the 248. So call it 260 for the sake of setting a decision altitude. So this is actually being quite misleading about what your decision altitude needs to be. It's not 248. It's actually 265, but you would probably say 270. AIP plates are not complete. All of them, depending on the systems you used, can be georeferenced, but obviously it makes life a lot easier if they are georeferenced. So here we've got an example of an AIP plate in Sky Demon, georeferenced with an aircraft moving over it, and then similarly a jet plate in one of the jet products, or one of the ones that has jet products included, georeferenced there. Another thing that I find very different between different ways of presenting plates and different plates is the indexing system. And you have to make sure you know how it works and to understand it. So my personal preference is Jet Flight Deck, which is the one on the left, which has a very simple indexing system. At the bottom, Sky Demon, which isn't a bad indexing system. And top right is actually Garmin Pilot, but I think that 4Flight is very similar. And I find it very hard to find my way around that kind of presentation as to what plate I'm looking for. But it's again a personal matter, but you might want to find a system that has the indexing system that works for you. Then there's a question of presentation. Are you going to show it in your GTN, your G500, on an iPad or on paper? Matter of personal choice, but my preference is iPad, but your preference may vary. But of course, the other side to all this, I mean, having said all that, everyone's going to want JEP, except when it comes down to the cost, because JEP costs a lot. Typically, Western Europe, I think, is around 600 or 700 euros a year. It's a lot of money. Of course, the AIP plates are free. You can just download them in your flight planning app. But they have the disadvantages I mentioned of inconsistency and lack of legibility and so on. So some people find that the happy compromise is to use Navigraph, which is very cheap. It's about, I think, about 60 euros for the whole world per year. So it's a trivial amount of money. But it has the disadvantage that you can't use it in flight. You either have to PDF or print out the ones you want to use. That can be inconvenient. So in terms of bang per buck, if you want to keep your costs down, my recommendation is to use Navigraph. Get the PDFs that you expect for your departure, destination, and alternate airfields onto your iPad as necessary. And then if you have to divert somewhere different, then needs must move across the AIP. But if you can afford to use JEP, that's obviously preferable. So the bottom line is I've talked about many, many different options for lots of different things, And the point I'd like to make is there are no right answers. Some people swear by ForeFlight, some people swear by Garmin Pilot. Personally, my preference is SkyDemon and JetFD. There are no right answers. And the same is true for all the other things we talked about, flight planning and so on. Just whatever works for you. So I think at this stage I'll take questions. I asked at the beginning that questions be submitted by chat. So let's first of all stop sharing, and then I will find my chats and let's see. Right. First question is, GAR. Yes, I didn't particularly mention the GAR. That is a cross-border requirements, filling out forms, and whoever asked this is absolutely right. You do need to take that into account. You need 24 hours for some places, for example, I think the Channel Islands under 12 hours. Many places arriving into the UK is 4 hours. Many places in Europe, you need to give 12 or 24 hours or even 48 hours notice to customs. And you're quite right, I should have mentioned that. Next question is about personal minima. Personally, I don't have personal minima. I have been a professional pilot for many years, and as far as I'm concerned, the minima in the book are the minima, so that's what I use. But some people may wish to apply personal minima. The point I'd make about personal minima is that they are planning minima. Once you set off, it's safer to fly down to minima than to go through than to do a go around, missed approach, diversion, and everything that entails. So you might decide you're not going to go anywhere that's got lower than, let's say, 400 feet cloud base or lower than 1500 meters visibility, whatever it might be. But if you fly there and get there and you discover that the cloud base is 200 feet and the visibility 1,000 RPR of 1,000, my recommendation is that you still continue with your flight and land, because that is safer than all the weather, terrain, and fuel considerations you have to make for a diversion. Right, next question. So yes, I've just covered the one about planning. Can you see how up-to-date the information is in Wintercom to ensure you aren't using out-of-date information? I'm not sure what the answer is, but my experience is that it is always relatively up-to-date. It uses the standard models. You can choose between five models. I can't name them. GFS is the obvious one, but there's a bunch of five models that you can choose from. And they will be forecast. I mean, bearing in mind they're models, so they're forecasts. So it doesn't really matter whether they're 12 hours old, 6 hours old, or whatever. So long as they are for the period that you're planning, that's what matters. How accurate have I found Gramet? I find Gramet remarkably accurate, though, as I say, it can depend on which model you use, and sometimes there's a difference between models, and then you need to sort of modify your view. Question: can filing Y or Z flight plans help with slot times? Not normally. Slot times are normally en route, and if they're to do with the airport, if they're runway or apron slot times, then being Y or Z isn't going to help. So I would say that the answer is probably no. Is there any point taking a plug with you if you're unlikely to get the planned route? Yes, you need the plug there for particularly for fuel planning and so on, and also in the event of equipment failure, whether it's radar failure on the ground or equipment failure in the air, you need to know what your plan is. So at any time, you could find yourself back to old-fashioned navigation with a radio failure. I mean, let's say you've got one GTN and that fails, then suddenly what you're left with isn't very much. So you might end up having to revert to your original plog and fly your planned route according to the radio failure rules. Would it be considered reckless if you flew a non-FICI aircraft in forecast icing conditions, providing you had an option of getting above or below? Reckless is a big word. I would say more, it's not a great idea. You should, in a non-FICI aircraft, you should not be planning to fly in icing conditions, would be my suggestion. And of course, that is why so many people flying IFR seriously do want de-iced aircraft. It increases your chance of dispatch. What would be the correct phraseology to ask ATC if there are thunderstorms on your track? What techniques do you use for in-flight? Oh, sorry, that's a separate question. So what would the correct phraseology be to ask ATC if there are thunderstorms? And I'm not sure whether that means to ask them if there are thunderstorms. In other words, I'm not sure if the question is to ask ATC whether there are thunderstorms on your track, or whether it means what to say to ATC if there are thunderstorms on your track, but I'll cover both. In areas which do have weather available from the radar controller, and as I say, that's mainly Germany, you would just say, I don't know, can you look ahead to me? Am I weather safe on this track, or does this track take me through any bad weather or anything like that? And they will generally come back and say either, yeah, if you maintain that track, you'll stay just to the east of activity over Stuttgart. Or they might say, I suggest a 20 degree right turn will keep you better clear of weather. That's the kind of conversation. I don't think there's a phraseology for it. It's a conversation, really. And then the correct phraseology to ATC, if there are thunderstorms on your track, then, as I said before, that's left 20 degrees for weather. And you have to put in the words for weather. What techniques you use for in-flight fuel planning? Well, it depends what equipment you've got. If you've got a GTN or a GNSS and something like a JPI or shade-in attached to it, then personally, I just keep a close eye on landing fuel, and that being enough fuel to hold and divert to an alternate. And of course, how much that diversion is depends on how far away it is. So for example, if I'm going into somewhere in the London area, then I'm much less concerned about that minimum fuel than I would be if I was going to, say, the Faroes, a very different matter. If otherwise, just the old-fashioned plog method of the how goes it, of you plan your fuel in advance on your plog, then at each waypoint or by time, depending on which is more often, you write down the actual fuel on board, compare it to the planned fuel, forecast ahead from there, and determine whether you're going to have minimum fuel at destination. Has PPLIR considered approaching Jeppesen to get a group discount? The answer is yes, we have done that. And generally speaking, local management say, wow, what a wonderful idea. And then it's stamped on by Jeppesen in the US. Any other questions by text before I move on? Okay. So just a couple of words about PPLIR Europe, which is a, I'll just share the screen again. Um, So it's a community of like-minded pilots, IFR pilots in Europe, who want to learn and share. We're all volunteers, but we're passionate about flying and using small aircraft to go places and ensure that the ability to fly general aviation and IFR is not lost to commercial flying, in other words, by lobbying and so on. Dedicated to help each other fly confidently and safely, inspiring new pilots to become more ambitious and get people to spread their wings and go further than they otherwise do. We publish the PBN manual, among other publications, and also a magazine. I would recommend that any any GA IFR pilot in Europe joins us on ppLIR.org. Thank you.